He says in the Quran, إِيُّرِيدَ إِصْلَاحًا يُوَفِّقِ اللَّهُ بَيْنَهُمَا. He says, if they intend reconciliation, if they intend to reform between each other, Allah gives them success. And in the same manner, if you came here tonight to reform between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to fix things up between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to mend this relationship between you and Allah azza wa jal, يُوَفِّقِ اللَّهُ بَيْنَهُمَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give such people success. Allah azza wa jal would give them success in their endeavor. He'd give them success in this pursuit, and he'll give them success in this intention. For make sure that you're here tonight, renew the intention that you're here to mend the relationship between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're all in need of this. The young and the old, the rich and the poor, and the sick and the healthy, and the black and the white, everyone needs this. Everyone needs to reform his relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if that's your intention for tonight, then bi-idhnillah, the promise of Allah is yuwaffiqillahu baynahuma. Allah azza wa jal would give them success. Allah azza wa jal would give you success in your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's the intention you're supposed to come to every lesson, and to every khutbah, and to every salat, and to every fasting, and every matter of worship you do. Your intention should be, إِيُّرِيدَ إِصْلَاحًا. That you're saying, oh Allah, I want islah with you. I want to mend this relationship with you, this broken relationship we have with Allah Azza wa Jal. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he gives us something called at-tawbah ila Allah. You know at-tawbah, the idea of at-tawbah, how serious is at-tawbah in your life? My brothers in Islam, at-tawbah, it comes from the word taba. Utaba means raja'a. Taba means to come back. Yani, what does tawbah mean? Tawbah means to come back. Come back to what? Where did you go away from to come back to? The idea of a tawbah is that a person has gone so far away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that now when he makes a tawbah and he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive him, and he asks Allah azza wa jal with sincerity and with honesty, a tawbah is that he comes back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For tawbah in itself, the word a tawbah is an acknowledgement from you that your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is struggling, that your relationship with Allah azza wa jal is broken, that your relationship with Allah azza wa jal is not where it's supposed to be. For this is at-tawbah, this is from Allah's generosity that he taught us the idea of at-tawbah, and he gave us the meaning at-tawbah. All of these meanings in al-Islam, you would not know them and you would not realize their importance if you don't know who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. This is why tonight, the lesson of tonight is titled In the Company of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the Company of Allah. It sounds something big. It sounds something precious. It sounds like a huge gift to be in the company of Allah azza wa jal. Wallah, and I don't doubt that there is not a single one among us. There is not a single person among us except that he wants to be in the company of Allah. Except that he desires to be in the company of Allah. Everyone wants that. The young and the old. Everyone. Even the sick that are in hospital would wish to be in the company of Allah. Even the dead want to be in the company of Allah. Even on the day of judgment, we want to be in the company of Allah. And even in the paradise, we want this company with Allah to continue. Even being in the company of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the biggest endeavor and is the biggest purpose and intention you're going to have in life, being with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Why do you want to be in the company of Allah? Why? Then the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, as Allah azza wa jal narrates al-hadith al-Qudsi, فَإِذَا أَحْبَبْتُهُ كُنْتُ سَمْعَهُ الَّذِي يَسْمَعُ بِهِ وَبَصَرَهُ الَّذِي يُبْصِرُ بِهِ وَيَدَهُ الَّتِي يَبْطِشُ بِهَا وَرِجْلَهُ الَّتِي يَمْشِي بِهَا وَلَئِنْ سَأَلَنِي لَأُعْطِيَنَّهُ وَلَئِنْ اسْتَعَاذَنِي لَأُعِيذَنَّهُ. Huge hadith. Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, and Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam paraphrases, yani this is hadith Qudsi. Allah said it. When Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam paraphrased it to us, what did Allah Azza wa Jal say? He says, therefore, if I was to love a servant, if Allah was to love someone, If you are in the company of Allah, what happens? كنت سمعه الذي يسمع به. Allah becomes your hearing in which you hear through. What does that mean? It means Allah Azza wa Jal would guide your ear to only hear that which is good. And he abstains it and keeps it away from hearing that which is bad. Al-gossip, evil talk, backbiting, slandering, swearing. And you might be feeling sometimes you're in a situation where people backbite each other and curse each other. And you're embarrassed, you feel shame. How am I going to get out of this? How am I going to talk? What advice should I give the people? You don't feel comfortable, but you're sitting. On the outside, you're sitting. You're not worried to move. When Allah Azza wa Jal loves a servant, when you're in the company of Allah, Allah makes sure from the very beginning that you're not in that kind of gathering altogether. كنت سمعه الذي يسمع به. Look at today, the problem. Today, the problem of atheism is growing. People are doubting Allah Azza wa Jal. Why? لأن their ease is not protected from the filth that they hear. The ease is not protected. إنما if you're a person in the company of Allah, Allah Azza wa Jal becomes the hearing of yours. يعني you're guided to that which is good. You only hear that which is good and you abstain from that which is bad by the permission of Allah. That's the benefit. Not only this, كنت سمعه الذي يسمع به وبصره الذي يبصر به. Allah becomes the sight that you'll see with. What does that mean? That means Allah would guide your eyes to see that which pleases Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. That you will find yourself developing this relationship with the Quran. You will find yourself reading the word of Allah and you can't get enough of it. كنت بصره الذي يبصر به. يعني that means that Allah Azza wa Jal would also protect you from seeing that which is filthy and haram. Shuf the complaint as well of the youth today that they cannot control their eyesight on the haram. And what's the excuse? Allah, today al-fitan are a lot. Where you flick through Facebook, through Instagram, through Snapchat, and it's all popping in front of you. It all pops up in front of you. From ads to people's profile to people are just all over the place today. People are all over the place today. People putting any picture of themselves. Women sell themselves so others can see them. Right? All of this. Anta, you say, wallah, this is the society we live in. What are we going to do? How do I save myself? Be in the company of Allah and Allah Azza wa Jal would become the sight in which you see in. And if Allah becomes your sight that you see through, then you will never see anything that displeases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you did, you'd be quick to notice it and move away from it. And you will not be tempted and desired by it. You will not develop a desire for it. كنت بصره الذي يبصر به. Allah Azza wa Jal, He says in this hadith, كنت سمعه الذي يسمع به وبصره الذي يبصر به ويده التي يبطش بها. And Allah Azza wa Jal becomes your hand. What does this mean? It means that Allah, your hand would be guided to only do that which pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it will refrain. And Allah would protect it from doing that which is al-haram. You'll find all of a sudden that your hand is taking you to al-halal. You'll find all of a sudden your hand is taking you to that which pleases Allah Azza wa Jal. And you question why? This is because Allah loved you. This is because now you're in the company of Allah. This is why. وَرِجْلَهُ الَّتِي يَمْشِي بِهَا. And Allah becomes his leg that he walks with. What does that mean? It means that you will be walking in the guidance of Allah, in the nur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your walking would be guided. You will find yourself walking to al-halal. You'll find yourself walking to al-masajid with no tiredness. And you with complete satisfaction and complete and ultimate pleasure. All of a sudden your feet are dragging you to al-masjid and you don't feel about it. This is how we understand. When one of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, he used to say that even among us Sahaba, if one of us was really sick and bedridden, لَيُهَادَى بَيْنَ الرَّجُلَيْنِ يُؤْتَى بِهِ إِلَى الْمَسْجِدِ. They used to balance him out and hold him between two men to take him to al-masjid. And the Sahaba used to be like this. When one of them was sick and bedridden and couldn't get up, two companions would go to his house. They would take him and he's balancing himself. He's walking and he's walking among the two companions and they're holding him until they come and they bring him to al-masjid. Where did he get this from? Physical strength he doesn't have. Look, he can barely get up. Two companions are supposed to carry him to get to the masjid. So what explains that? How did he come to the masjid? How is he consistent? Even though he has a concession, he can sit at home. But why did they prefer to come? لأن الله سبحانه وتعالى has become the leg in which he walks with. وكنت رجله التي يمشي بها. Even the idea was spiritual strength. They had spiritual strength. Why they were in the company of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wallah azza wa jal protected them. Wallah azza wa jal gave them that spiritual strength. For now, sick, not sick, whatever the situation is, he hasn't forgotten Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hasn't forgotten Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No matter what the situation is, you're never supposed to forget Allah azza wa jal. Never. Even in, يعني, in the... سيد الاستغفار, you know سيد الاستغفار, what's سيد الاستغفار, نبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, he teaches us this hadith, سيد الاستغفار, it's a dua, it's found in صحيح البخاري, يعني it's an authentic hadith, نبي صلى الله عليه وسلم teaches us to say سيد الاستغفار in the morning and in the afternoon, what's his result, if you were to say it with complete conviction and certainty, then if you die that morning you enter the paradise. And if you were to say it in the afternoon with conviction and certainty and die in the afternoon, you enter the paradise. Sayyidul Istighfar is when you do any kind of sin, you say it. But the idea, why am I bringing this hadith for you? لأن the beginning of Sayyidul Istighfar is what? Allahumma anta rabbi la ilaha illa anta. How does it end? How does that hadith, how does this dhikr end? فَغْفِرْ لِي فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ. Sayyid al-Istighfar, the end of it is to say, oh Allah, forgive me. No one forgives the sins but you. But the beginning of it was what? Allahumma anta rabbi la ilaha illa ant. Even the idea was from the very beginning of this dhikr to acknowledge who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is for you. That the first words you said, you did not rush to say, forgive me. You said, Allahumma anta rabbi. Oh Allah, you're my Lord. Even though I have sinned, I still acknowledge you're my Rabb. Even though I have done what I've done, I will begin my forgiveness. I will begin asking and seeking your forgiveness by acknowledging that Anta Rabbi. Even in that second that I was sinning, Anta Rabbi. Allahumma Anta Rabbi. La ilaha illa Ant. No Lord worthy of worship but you. Khalaqtani. Wa ana abduk. I am that weak slave of yours. I'm that humbled, humiliated slave of yours. Wa ana abduk. Subhanallah, khalaqtani wa ana abduk. And then the hadith goes on. But the idea was to know who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. To acknowledge Allah azza wa jalla in all of your times. For Nabi, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said in that hadith, فَإِذَا أَحْبَبْتُهُ, once you're in the company of Allah, كُنْتُ سَمْعَهُ الَّذِي يَسْمَعُ بِهِ وَبَصَرَهُ الَّذِي يُبْصِرُ بِهِ وَيَدَهُ الَّتِي يَبْطِشُ بِهَا وَرِجْلَهُ الَّتِي يَمْشِي بِهَا. And on top of all of this, two more things. وَلَئِنْ سَأَلَنِي لَأُعْطِيَنَّهُ. And any time he was to ask me, I will give him. وَلَئِنْ سَأَلَنِي. Any time. خلاص, you got an open check with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. An open signed check with Allah azza wa jalla. Ask for anything you want. لَأُعْطِيَنَّهُ. هذا لَأُعْطِيَنَّهُ, this word is guarantee. Allah is saying it, I will give him. Allahu Akbar. Being in the company of Allah azza wa jalla, one of its benefits is that any time you turn to Allah, Allah gives you of the good. وَلَئِنْ سَأَلَنِي لَأُعْطِيَنَّهُ. Any kind of good you're going to ask, Allah will deliver it to you, will give it to you. يعني هو, don't understand from this as well that whatever it is you want, you ask, and then you say after a few days, Allah didn't give me what I want. لَهُوَ, if Allah عز وجل was to not give you something, then because you're in the company of Allah, Allah is protecting you from that thing. Maybe it's not good for you. Allah Azza wa Jal keeps it away from you. That's Allah Azza wa Jal's company for you. That's Allah Azza wa Jal being with you. That's Allah protecting you. Al-Hafiz subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees something upon someone, it always comes, if it's a bad decree, if it's something that you view as something bad, Allah Azza wa Jal is always with you. Then when Allah Azza wa Jal's decree, الشر that Allah has decreed for you, the evil, the apparent evil you see that Allah has decreed for you, it comes down with Allah's compassion and gentleness. There is no difficulty that Allah Azza wa Jal bestows upon you except that it is injected with a lot of Allah's gentleness and mercy and compassion. Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, إِنَّ رَبِّي لَطِيفٌ لِمَا يَشَاءُ. Allah Azza wa Jal is Latif. From his names is Al-Latif, the gentle, the compassionate. Did you see the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam? When his people threw him in a fire, what happens? What happens? He's in a difficulty. He's in a fire. He's literally burning. He's entered a place where it literally burns. But Allah Azza wa Jal's gentleness is with him. قُلْنَا يَا نَارُ كُونِي بَرْدًا وَسَلَامًا عَلَىٰ إِبْرَاهِيمٍ. Allah Azza wa Jal gives command to the fire that it be cool and peaceful on Ibrahim alayhi salam. بَرْدًا وَسَلَامًا. Cool and tranquil, peaceful. Because if it was only cool, he would have froze to death. And if it was peaceful without being cool, he would have burned. For Allah Azza wa Jal gave it two commands. بَرْدًا وَسَلَامًا. Sometimes you read it, Bardan wa Salaman 2 in 1, it's the same thing. It's not the same thing. Allah Azza wa Jal's matters are decreed precisely. Bardan wa Salaman is the only solution for him right now. For he's in the midst of difficulty, but Allah's gentleness and compassion is with him. Why? Why Allah Azza wa Jal gave him that companionship? Why did Allah Azza wa Jal look after him? You know why? Because when he was thrown in the fire, he said, Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakeel. Hasbunallah. The first thing on his mind was Allah. Therefore, he deserved ultimate protection. Then that was the first thing in his mind. See, I tell you, everyone wants to be in the company of Allah so that Allah can do with us like what he did with Ibrahim. But you will only get the company of Allah if you know in times of difficulty to say Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakeel. Hasbunallah means Allah is enough for us. Hasbunallah, Allah is enough for us. Wa ni'mal wakeel. And how excellent is Allah as a being to rely on. Wa ni'mal wakeel. Ibrahim alayhi salam saved himself from a fire, from a difficulty with Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakeel. Do you know how to save yourself with Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakeel? Do you know how to say it in difficulties and make the difficulty bardan wa salaman and make your difficulty become a cool and a source of peace and tranquility for you? The fire became a source of tranquility. Tranquility and peace is what people are running after. Ibrahim found it in the fire. It's not the idea that he found peace in the fire. But he found it with the word Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakeel. And after that was a bonus. After that, the fire being peaceful and cool upon him is because that's Allah's promise to those that want his companionship. That's Allah's promise. Allah Azza wa Jal is with them. Wa ana ma'ahu idha dhakarani. And I'm with my servant whenever he remembers me. For even going back to the hadith, وَلَئِنْ سَأَلَنِي لَأُعْطِيَنَّهُ. If Ibrahim didn't even ask, this is a higher level. This is a high level of companionship with Allah. That you don't even ask. You just remember Allah, Hasbunallah. Allah Azza wa Jal knows what he wants. And he fulfilled his request. You know how to deal with Allah Azza wa Jal like this? Now what happens with us? If a difficulty happens, you'd say Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakeel a million times, it doesn't work. Why doesn't it work? How come it worked with Ibrahim once? Today we repeat, nothing happens. You know why? What happened? What changed? Allah did not change. The same Ilah that saved Ibrahim with Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakeel is the same Ilah, is the same Lord that has guaranteed the same matter. What happened? And we're the ones that changed. Our heart is the one that changed. Our relationship with Allah Azza wa Jalla is what changed. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. Allah Azza wa Jalla promised, he will never change the state of a person. He will never change the state of a people until they change what's in themselves. You're the one that has to change. Allah hasn't changed. Allah is as he is. سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى. When you say Subhanallah, it means I declare the perfection of Allah. This is what it means. Sometimes, subhanAllah, you read its translation, glory be to Allah. What does glory mean anyway? No one knows what glory means. Stay on a perfect translation. Subhanallah means I declare Allah's perfectness. Allah is perfect. This is what subhanAllah means. Allah hasn't changed. We're the ones that have changed. For unless we turn back to Allah, unless we know who Allah is, unless we show serious commitment and dedication to learn who Allah Azza wa Jal is, حسبنا الله ونعم الوكيل will never work. It will never work. شوف إبراهيم عليه السلام. So when you look at Ibrahim عليه السلام as a prophet of Allah, what did he do to learn about Allah? What did he do? Because we said that the highest aspiration you have in life is to be in the company of Allah. Because being in the company of Allah results in these benefits that Allah Azza wa Jalla is with you wherever you are. But for you to be in Allah's company and to gain these benefits, you have to know who Allah is. How does it make sense to worship a Lord you don't know who He is? You see, most of the demotivation we have in worship is because we don't know who Allah is. If we knew who Allah Azza wa Jal was, as-salat would be 100%. And every ibadah and every worship in life would be 100%. And you wouldn't have questions like what questions we hear today after Ramadan. Shaykh, can you give us a talk after Ramadan? How do we keep going in our worship? How do we remain steadfast after Ramadan? And that these questions the Sahaba never used to ask. And that these are new questions. After that time, then today we ask these questions. I lost motivation to pray. Advise me, how do I continue to pray? All these matters were assumed in the past. No one fell into something like this. These are the problems and the questions of today. The people did not know who Allah is. You say, how do I remain steadfast after Ramadan? The answer is, go learn about Allah. Because when you know Him, you'll find the strength to worship Him. Then you know who you're worshiping. For Ibrahim alayhi salam, حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلِ, it saved him. What did Ibrahim do to learn about Allah? Allah Azza wa Jal records a story for him in the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah. وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ رَبِّ أَرِنِي كَيْفَ تُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى. Ibrahim alayhi salam got to a point in life where he asked Allah, show me how you revive the dead. أَرِنِي كَيْفَ تُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى. Show me. Yani the idea is Ibrahim alayhi salam is not asking, oh Allah, do you revive the dead? He believes in that. He knows that. He's saying, show me how you do it. Show me how you revive the dead. Otherwise, a few ayat before, when Ibrahim alayhi salam was with the king An-Namrud. Remember An-Namrud, the story of An-Namrud, the king. When he came in, when An-Namrud said, Ana uhyi wa umit, I give life and I take life. And then Ibrahim said, Rabbi alladhi yuhyi wa yumit, my Lord is the one who gives life and takes life. Ibrahim believes this. Ibrahim knows this already. But what's Ibrahim doing here? When he says to Allah, show me how you revive the dead. Al ulama rahimahum Allah, they said, arada an yartaqi min ilm al yaqin ila ayn al yaqin. He wanted to advance from the knowledge of certainty to the eye of certainty. He has the knowledge that Allah revives the dead, but now he wants to see how Allah revives the dead. Upgrade. He wants to update his knowledge about Allah Azza wa Jal. And we're speaking about Ibrahim alayhi salam, the one who Allah Azza wa Jal took him as a friend. واتخذ الله إبراهيم خليلا. He was in the company of Allah because of his dedication to learn about Allah. أرني كيف تحيي الموتى. He wants to see. For Allah Azza wa Jal, he said to him, أولم تؤمن. Don't you believe? Don't you believe that I revive the dead? For Ibrahim alayhi salam said, Bala, of course I believe. ولكن ليطمئن قلبي. However, I want to feel satisfaction and contentment in my heart. ليطمئن قلبي. This is what he wants, Ibrahim alayhi salam. In other words, the more you seek and you pursue after knowledge and to learn Allah, what's its result? لِيَطْمَئِنَّ قَلْبِي. It gives peace and satisfaction in the heart. The more eager you are about learning about Allah Azza wa Jal, the more satisfaction is in the heart. وَلَكِنْ لِيَطْمَئِنَّ قَلْبِي. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He wants to show him. لأنه إبراهيم عليه السلام is honest. إبراهيم عليه السلام is sincere. He wants to learn about Allah. For Allah Azza wa Jal is going to give him some knowledge. But look at this now. It's not going to come easy. Yani you first have to prove your dedication and commitment that you want to learn about Allah. And then the road is not easy. Show your effort. Prove your effort. So Allah Azza wa Jal now, He says to Ibrahim عليه السلام فخذ أربعة من الطير فصرهن إليك. Go and collect four birds. Four birds. Four birds. العلماء رحمهم الله, they have a long discussion. What kind of birds did he have? Some said one of them was a goose, a pigeon, a chicken. Whatever it is, it was four birds. أربعة من الطير فصرهن إليك. Step one in this experiment. Grab the birds, four birds. Next step, صرهن إليك. صرهن من التصيير. Chop them up. Chop them up. He'd grab them. And he began to grab. Rip their feathers off. Break the bones. Dislocate their bones and rip them apart. The flesh, the skin, the blood, the veins, everything is all over the place. Of four birds. فصرهن إليك. Chop them up really well. Because they have to die. Then Allah is going to show you how He is going to revive the dead. So kill them. Now if you told Ibrahim to put them back, he wouldn't be able to. No one in the world would be able to bring it back together. خلاص, it's gone, it died in front of him. The bird is gone, motionless. And on top of that, it's all scattered all over the place. فَصُرْهُنَّ إِلَيْكَ. Then he said to him, next step. That's step one. Stage two. ثُمَّ اجْعَلْ عَلَى كُلِّ جَبَلٍ مِّنْهُنَّ جُزْءًا. Go to the peak of a number of mountains and divide this pile of dead birds, divide it up into small parts, and take a part and go to a mountain and put it on top of a mountain. Come back down, take another part, go on top of a mountain and put it on top. Some ulama said he had to go and place parts of the bird over four mountains. Some said no, over seven mountains. Some said more than that. The idea is this. Do you know how long it takes to go up a mountain? Mount Everest, with just a quick research, it takes 2 months to get to the peak of a mountain, Mount Everest. Well, this is not like an expedition and a holiday anyone does. People die as they go up on Mount Everest. Some people don't make it. Look, Ibrahim alayhi salam is ready. He's ready to tackle this hardship and difficulty to learn about Allah Azza wa Jal. Well, he already knows Allah revives the dead, but he wants to see it. He wants more knowledge of Allah. It's not going to come easy. You're literally going to climb a mountain to know that knowledge about Allah is going to require sacrifice and dedication. And you're going to get tired like going up a mountain. For he went up a mountain. Allahu alam how long the mountain is to go up. You know, today the mountains are shorter in size because of erosion and so on. But back then, mountains were high. And every few centuries, mountains decrease in size. Until eventually on the Day of Judgment, all the mountains are plucked from the earth and nothing remains. All of it is gone. وَيَوْمَ نُسَيِّرُ الْجِبَالِ. They're all gone, finished. فَإِبْرَاهِيمُ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامُ goes and puts a part of a bird on the mountain. Come back down. Go back up. The idea is, Allahu A'lam, this would have taken months, years. And at that time, his people are suffering. His community are in need of da'wah. So it's not like Ibrahim said, Ya Rabbah, nah, I need quick access to knowledge of yours because I gotta go back and look after my people and give them da'wah and see their needs. And la, there's no rush when you seek knowledge of Allah. But you want Allah's protection. You have to know who Allah is. You have to learn about Allah Azza wa Jal, so that when you say Hasbunallah, even if you're in a fire, it'll work. فإبراهيم عليه السلام, Allah says to him, ثم اجعل على كل جبل منهن جزءا. After he finished, what a huge project it was. What's all this for? We're about to see what he's going to learn. He put all that and he came down. Allah Azza wa Jal now gives him the next step. ثم ادعوهن. Call them. Call the birds. They're dead. Well, call them. Call them. You're going to see now Allah's ability over all things. Allah is going to teach you something. You're going to see how Allah would revive the dead. For he said to the birds, come. Udu'uhun. Allah said to him, Ya'teenaka sa'ya. They will come running to you. Just call them. For he called them. Wal mufassirun rahimahum Allah, they said, and as he called them, he saw the parts of the birds began to assemble in the air. A feather from this mountain would go to this mountain and connect to this bird. A bone from this one will go to this mountain to connect with the bird. A vein from here and a vein from there. Skin cells and blood cells. Things you can't even see with the naked eye. Allah is bringing it all up together and He's seeing it. Four birds are formed in front of His eye. In no time. Kun fayakun. This is a...